morning.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading is found on page 643 of your pew Bibles. And we're reading 1 Timothy chapter 2. The first 15 verses, once again, page 643, if you want to use your pew Bibles. 1 Timothy chapter 2, and the first 15 verses. The Word of God says, "First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people, kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. For this, I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. I desire then that in every place that men should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarreling. Likewise, also that women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel with modesty and self-control, not with braided hair and gold or pearls or costly attire, but with what is proper for women who profess godliness, with good works. Let a woman learn quietly with all submissiveness. I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man, rather she is to remain quiet. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Yet she will be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith and love and holiness with self-control."
You may be seated. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we need your Holy Spirit to be doing a work in our lives, to be equipping us and empowering us to trust you and trust your scripture. Lord, help us as we see your commands in scripture. Help us to not just see isolated commands, but see your loving way of helping us to look more like you, the image that we're created in. Lord, I pray that your voice through your scripture this morning would be heard loud and clear, and that we would not only hear your voice, but that we would feel your love and your compassion. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Right now, we are going through the book of 1 Timothy. One of the things that we love to do here at Hoffman Street Baptist Church is to go through books of the Bible. One thing that's great about that is that we have a more full understanding of what Scripture is talking about when we can see the Scripture in its context. The bad thing about that for me is there are random times when we get more visitors than normal, and it turns out to be on a more controversial passage. That has happened this morning. It is not my goal to belittle anyone. Instead, my goal this morning is to help us as followers of Jesus Christ grow in our ability to understand Scripture and to recognize that God's commands are not just silly rules, but instead they're His loving way of drawing us to look more like Him. We may not always see the danger around the corner that God is protecting us from, but just like a parent doesn't say, "Don't run into the middle of the street just because the kid doesn't see the car," God, our loving Father, wants to call us into the right type of community safety that He has designed us for. For those of you who have not been here and have not seen the progression for how we have gotten to here, just this chapter, this is the third time that we're preaching on this chapter. First, we started off looking at how we should pray and who we should be praying for. What different types of prayer should we be engaging in? Last week, we saw that men, instead of using our fists and our hands for anger, are to lift our hands in prayer and worship.
Amen.
And we also saw the instruction that was directed primarily towards women, but something that we can all learn from, is that we are to spend more time putting on righteousness and following after God than we are to spend trying to dress up and look spectacular for everyone else to see. This week we are looking at the subjects of authority and the image of God. And sometimes, because of our history in the past, what we have experienced, or trying to reconcile two thoughts that don't quite seem to fit together, we either seem to lift up and say, all right, everybody is exactly the same and equal. One thing I want us to remember is that our value does not come from our authority. Our value comes from who Jesus is and the death he died on the cross in our place.
Yeah.
If you're here and you're not used to church, what I want you to see is that we're going to be talking about commands and instructions that are found in Scripture today. But those fit into the overarching story that we find in the Bible, that God is a loving God who created all human beings in his image. We've strayed from that. We've chosen to do our own thing. But still, God keeps coming after us. God keeps loving us. God keeps trying to draw us to him. And part of the way that he does that is through his protection in his commands. So we're going to be looking at God's love. And also the way that God has created us to be different from each other this morning. When the Apostle Paul writes his letters, he follows his own train of thought. And sometimes from the outside looking in, it can feel a bit sporadic or random to us. In order to better understand today's scripture, I want you to understand his thought progression. Paul begins chapter 2 giving instructions on who we should be praying for. He moves on from there to giving instructions to men on how men should pray. And then, since he has addressed the behavior of men during corporate prayer and worship, he moves on to addressing women and women's behavior during corporate worship as well. Understanding the flow of Paul's thoughts and logic has helped me to understand chapter 2 of 1 Timothy not as a random set of commands about women, but a fluid instruction that fits under Paul's overall objective of helping Timothy and helping the church that Timothy pastors to know how they ought to behave in the house of God, the church. We'll find and we will see that objective more clearly stated when we get to the second half of chapter 3. But I want us to understand Paul's commands are loving instruction for us. Paul's commands are a way of protecting us. They are not chauvinistic rules. They are not ways of putting women down as being lesser than men. I want you to know that I grew up rejecting portions of passages like our passage for today. It just didn't feel right to me that God was creating this distinction between men and women. It didn't seem like it made sense for there to be authority differences. When I read them, I viewed them as outdated and derogatory towards women. It has taken years of the Holy Spirit working through Scripture in my life to bring me to a different understanding of both the trustworthiness of Scripture and God's view of women expressed in Scripture. As followers of Jesus, we trust 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, which says all Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. All of Scripture is there to help us be complete for and competent for every good work that God has set out for us. That means that when we don't like a Scripture that we read, we are either misunderstanding the Scripture, we are totally wrong, or we're both.
Amen.
When you and I recoil at some of Scripture's teaching, it stems out of our sinful, broken, wrong thinking. And we know that it's our sinful, broken, wrong thinking because the Bible is inspired by God. The Bible can be misused and it can be misunderstood, but it is never wrong. This passage of Scripture is here so that you and I will be equipped for every good work that God has prepared beforehand. Now we should recognize what this passage is and is not saying. This passage of Scripture is not saying that women are less loved by God than men. This scripture is not saying that women are less capable than men. This scripture is not saying that women are more sinful than men. So what is the truth? What is this scripture saying? What do we know from the Bible? God loves and values women just as much as he loves and values men. Women are just as capable and often more capable than men. Men and women... My wife rooted a little too excitedly about that. Men and women are equally corrupted by sin.
Come on.
Men and women are not the same as each other. Men and women complement one another. We're like two puzzle pieces that fit together and create a more beautiful picture. So let's use my wife and I as an example. Christine is very different from me. Jesus loves both of us so much that he was willing to die on the cross in our place. Jesus loves to give both of us good and perfect gifts. I think that Christine is actually more capable than I am in many respects. I know that Christine is better at handling stress than I am most of the time. Christine and I have some sinful tendencies that are similar to each other, and some sinful tendencies that are very different from the other. When it comes down to it, Christine and I are both made in the image of God, and both show His image in distorted ways. In fact, I'm pretty sure that I'm more sinful and rebellious than my wife is.
Come on.
God made Christine and I to be different from each other, to complement and to challenge one another. In those differences, we complement the other much more effectively than we would if we were the exact same. A common reaction among Christians to a passage like this, or to this passage in particular, is to say things like this. Paul is addressing a cultural situation that no longer applies today. If that was the case, Paul would have either tied it to a cultural situation, or he wouldn't have given a reason for it at all. For example, earlier in this passage, I think around verse 8 or 9, Paul talks about braided hair and that women shouldn't braid hair, their hair. It doesn't mean that braiding hair is inherently sinful. But if we understand history and the context more often, what we'd find is that women in that culture at that time, specifically, they would braid their hair if they were prostitutes to let guys know, come holla at me. I'm available. I'm ready to sell my body. And so that is tied to something that is cultural. He doesn't say why, and we understand now that it's cultural as we look at history. But the thing that's different in talking about authority issues within the church and who is to be the primary teachers in the church, what we find the Apostle Paul doing is he ties it back to creation. Paul ties the prohibition of women exercising authority over men back to the creation story. He says, man was formed first. In tying it back to the creation story, what the Apostle Paul is saying is God gave authority and created an authority structure in which husbands and leaders and the people of God have authority over their wives and the congregation as a whole. So what does this mean for us? It means that in the church, women are allowed to serve in most ways, so long as it is not inverting God's created authority structure. A misuse of this scripture is to imply that all women are under the authority of all men. That's a load of manure.
Yeah. Come on.
Yeah. Single women are under the authority of their fathers and under the protection of their fathers. Married women are under the authority and protection of their husbands. and obedience to Jesus, our Heavenly Father, our heavenly authority, outranks our need even to obey earthly authorities. So if your husband or father tells you to do something sinful, listen to Jesus instead.
Yep.
I'm talking to you, Christine. If your husband tells you to do something, while everyone in the church is under the authority and the protection of elders and overseers, which we often call pastors in our culture, we see that Titus chapter 2 encourages older men to teach younger men and older women to teach younger women. I want you to know that this is a built-in protection for the people of God. God does not intend for a young pastor like me to be the primary mentor of any young women unless they are my daughter. Even then, it's a responsibility to be shared by both parents if possible. I want you to know that my primary mentors are not women outside of my family. That doesn't mean that I can't learn from many women. I have learned over and over and been schooled like crazy by women throughout my life. It would be foolish of me, though, to develop that kind of relationship where my primary mentor, where that deep spiritual bond is formed between a woman who is not my wife or a family. Just like it would be unwise for a woman to form that type of deep spiritual bond with a man who is not her husband or her father. And one of the reasons for that is that is the way that emotional affairs and physical affairs happen in the church, is when we go to someone other than the person that God has created to be that person, to care for us, to protect us, to complete us. When we mix up those types of relationships, when we spend alone time praying and doing deep Bible study, we develop attachments that, if not kept in check, can be quite unhealthy and lead not just to the destruction of a person or two, but also to the destruction and to the reputation of God in the community that surrounds us. 5 or 6 years ago, the pastor of a megachurch in our area wound up having a long-term affair with an underage woman in our community and wound up serving prison time for it. I'm going to give the guy the benefit of the doubt, and I'm going to give the girl the benefit of the doubt, that they didn't go into that relationship hoping for a sexual encounter. But in developing a relationship that was not ordained by God, they wound up in uncharted and unhealthy waters. And the primary responsibility of that falls on the pastor. Falls on the man who took advantage of his position. This is why, no matter who you are in the church, you need to be guarding yourself, guarding your relationships. This is why I try not to meet one-on-one with women anywhere near my age range. I always try to bring other people along with me. In fact, when I first started pastoring here, we had Sunday night and Wednesday night services. And by the time that services would often be done or study was completed, it would be dark outside, everybody was rushing to get home, and there were several times when I was left packing things up and the only person left was a young single woman. And so instead of doing what I would normally do, where I would be packing up and just chatting with the people who were hanging around, instead I left my stuff there and I would guide us out onto the steps out into the parking lot so that there would be no opportunity for temptation, so that there would be no opportunity for gossip or slander to be made about the situation. I want us to know that these rules, that these commands, that these instructions are there for our protection. God's commands, whether you understand them or not, are for your protection because He loves you so. When we look at authority issues in the Bible, we are seeing God's instruction to restore us to His perfect image. Even within the Godhead, also known as the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit have differing roles and authority. When we embrace authority in the church and in the home, we are embracing the fact that God has made us in His own image to be in authority and under authority. Now, what I don't want us to take from this is to think that this is an opportunity where we can disrespect or dishonor women. Jesus honored women. He honored His mother. He honored women who were both sinful and godly because they are made by Him in His image. Jesus came to die for men and women equally. Jesus came to restore the kind of community that He created us to live in. Jesus created us in His image, and He created us to have different roles than any other person in the world. That same God left the comforts of heaven and came to earth as the man Jesus Christ, who lived the perfect life of obedience and love towards God that you and I haven't. He died the death that you and I deserve to die, suffering separation from God. And then He rose from the grave so that you and I, if we place our hope and faith in Jesus, can know that we will one day be raised too.
Thank you, man.
Restored completely and wholly into the community that God created us for. If Jesus is willing to love us so sacrificially and give us His Holy Spirit, we can sacrifice our sinful desire to only be accountable to ourselves and no one else. You can rejoin godly community and submit to God-ordained authority because the Holy Spirit lives in you and me and is willing to do the work in us. Will you listen to the call of the Holy Spirit this morning and choose God's way rather than your own? I want those of us who embrace authority and gender differences in the home and in the church to ask ourselves a question. Do you treat women like they are made fully and completely in the image of God? Or do you treat them as if they are worth less than a man? If you treat women with less dignity, value, and respect because they are women, I am calling you to repent right now. Authority and value are not the same. Jesus is fully God, yet obeys the authority of God the Father. Our value is not tied to our authority. Instead, our value is tied to the fact that Jesus Christ died on the cross in our place. Will you follow Jesus and love people by honoring and obeying his commands and treating all people with dignity, value, and respect in spite of differences, power, and authority? That's what you want. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much that you are our God, that you love us so fully and completely. We ask that you would be working in our hearts, that you would be breaking down our barriers to trusting you and your instruction. And Lord God, for those of us who have misused and abused passages like this, Lord, soften our hearts, bring us to repentance. And help us to honor each other because we are all